Imagine that you are not watching the microcosmos right now. Instead, imagine you are living in the world as it existed around 1 billion years ago. And you are the ancestor of this red algae. Inside of you lies the DNA that you have painstakingly acquired from your ancestors. It contains the instructions for everything from the walls of your cellular body to the components of your organelles. That DNA has changed and accumulated through randomness and selection over billions of years, and you are the masterpiece sculpted by that process. Except, you are about to lose a quarter of your genes. The history of red algae can be told in part through what they have gained, lost, and given away over billions of years. It begins with a tale that is familiar to many of us in the microcosmos. A long, long, long time ago, a eukaryote consumed a cyanobacterium, only to convert it into a photosynthetic organelle called a plastid. This process is known as endosymbiosis, and the organisms descended from that eukaryote are now known as the archaeplastida, which is made up of three groups. Green algae and land plants are considered one of those groups. And then there's the other group of algae called the glaucophytes, and then there are the red algae called rhodophyta. Like their archaeplastid counterparts, red algae have chlorophyll, but they also possess other pigments that help with photosynthesis and also often turn them red. Now, when you hear the word algae, your mind might first conjure up images of the greener archaeplastids, but red algae is also widespread and influential. For starters, if you eat nori, you are actually eating red algae. And red algae's impact goes far beyond that. As we've just said, red algae got their photosynthetic plastids through endosymbiosis, but they also essentially gave their plastids to others through endosymbiosis. Many organisms, like diatoms, can trace the origins of their photosynthetic capabilities to an ancestor that consumed and converted a red algae plastid into its own machinery. So red algae have a legacy that spans far beyond their own actions. They show up embedded in the ways that other organisms are able to live, in every bit of food they derive from the sun and the chemical byproducts that sustain us all. But for all that red algae were able to gain and share through endosymbiosis, their history is also marked by the things they've lost, like their genes. One of the things that is really striking about red algae is they don't seem to have that many genes compared to other eukaryotes. And more weirdly, it seems like they actually once did have more genes. They just lost them. It's hard to pick apart exactly how red algae lost their genes, and we can't say if it happened very suddenly or if it was more a gradual chipping away at their genomes. But based on the species they're able to study today, scientists think there were at least two major phases of genome reduction. The first likely involved some old lineage of red algae, which likely lost about 25% of their genes. And in this process, they lost a key feature, the flagellum, that thread-like structure that many eukaryotes use to drive themselves around. And there are some interesting implications to losing the flagellum, especially for an aquatic organism like red algae that would probably want to be able to swim to locations that allow them better access to light or to find other algae to reproduce with. But perhaps that ancestral red algae was living in conditions where the energy required to make flagella and operate them just wasn't worth it. Maybe it just thrived without the flagellum and there was never a reason to keep it. In that case, that ancestral red algae's loss seems to have been justified, because red algae are thriving without their flagella and without any number of other pathways that were lost with those genes. And in fact, in the second phase, another red algae would reduce its genome by another 25%. The descendants of that algae became members of a group known as cyanodiophytina. The algae within this group, and particularly those from the class Cyanidiophyceae, are particularly well studied because they are extremophiles, meaning they're found in environments that are incredibly difficult to survive in. Heat, acid, metal, salt, all things that we might be able to tolerate in a very specific range, but these red algae extremophiles are not fazed. Some can survive in acidic environments whose pH values range from 0 to 4. For context, the least painful end of that scale would be like living in acid rain, the most painful like battery acid. And as far as temperature goes, there are species that can survive at 56 degrees Celsius, or 132 degrees Fahrenheit. So the reason we're not actually featuring any cyanidiophytes is that they tend to be found in places like volcanoes or hot springs. No, our red algae are their tamer cousins, found living along a Spanish beach. But how could the cyanidiophytes have survived such extreme conditions when they have lost so much of their genome? Surely those genes were useful for something. Maybe, but it turns out the cyanidiophytes had a backup plan. They could get the genes they needed from their neighbors. There's a process scientists have been unraveling over the past few decades called horizontal gene transfer, where genetic material gets moved from one species to another. And in general, we know it as a process that happens in prokaryotes, driven by viruses or other vectors that are able to transfer DNA from one organism to another. And prokaryotes are well suited to not only take genetic material this way, but also to quickly embed those changes in their population as they divide asexually. Eukaryotes seemed unlikely to engage in horizontal gene transfer, if only because we couldn't really find examples of it. But when scientists studied the genome of Cyanidiophyceae algae, they found hundreds of genes in them that seemed to come from bacteria and that seemed to help with various functions like surviving high temperatures or salty conditions. And so, the same group of organisms that lost so much of itself also found a way to gain so much from others, adopting the genes of other organisms into their own way of life. And the most exciting thing is how much there still is to learn. We still really don't know that much about how horizontal gene transfer shows up in the history of eukaryotes. We don't know whether red algae have gone through other major phases of genome reduction. We know simply that nature's boundaries are porous and its identities are multifaceted. Thank you for coming on this journey with us as we explore the unseen world that surrounds us. The people on your screen right now, they are the people who allow us to spend so much time gathering beautiful footage and also beautiful and wonderful and bizarre stories of our world and then to combine them for you to look at here on Journey to the Microcosmos. If you would like to be one of those people, there's a way to do that. You just go to patreon.com/journeytomicro. If you'd like to see more from our master of microscopes, James Weiss, you can check out Jam and Germs on Instagram. And if you want to see more from us, there's always a subscribe button somewhere nearby.